Welcome, everybody. Welcome to class one of understanding and living your gospel identity. Thank you so much for signing to be a part of the School of Discipleship here at Summit View. And so before we even get going, I just want to let you know how excited I am that you've signed up to take this course. I know it's a big step sometimes to want to commit to something for 8 weeks, but my hope and prayer is that as you join us walking through understanding who God has made us to be and understanding how we relate to Him and the life that He calls us to live, that this would truly be a blessing to you in your studies. Whether you've been a Christian for a few days, a few weeks, maybe years, or maybe you're watching this class and you wouldn't even consider yourself a Christian yet, I want to let you know that this class, regardless of your background, is for you. And so for the next 8 weeks, my hope and prayer is that as we look at what it means to be a follower of Jesus, somebody who loves God, that even your affections for God would increase. And so just so you know, our staff, our pastors, our elders, we're praying for you over the next couple weeks that this would really take root within your heart and within your soul, and you'd have a firm foundation and understanding of who God has made you to be and what He's invited you into in a relationship with Him. And so I want to encourage you that as you join us each week, have a Bible handy. Be ready to study alongside with us as we go to different passages, and make sure that as you're reading through your books, make good notes. Write things down, because part of the course is having an opportunity to interact with one another. And so we look forward to growing alongside with you for the next 8 weeks. And so as we start off and as we look at living and understanding our gospel identity, we need to start with where it comes from. We need to start with really, how does a gospel identity even begin to get formed, and what is a gospel identity? Because depending on your background and depending on what churches maybe you've been a part of, or if you've ever gone to conferences, the gospel is a word that is thrown out a lot. Identity is a concept that is spoken of all over the place. And when we talk about gospel identity, it could be even more confusing because there's so many different ways in which people define that. And so, if we're honest, we're really prone to wanting to find our identity in a lot of things, whether it's the schools that you went to, the schools your children went to, the size of your bank account, the kind of car you drive, the type of vacations that you take. We seem to want to find our value and worth and really base our identity that we put forward on social media or in conversations with friends on things that are fairly fleeting. Things that are good in of themselves, but they can't be the pinnacle of our identity. And you probably know that if you've ever placed one of those things as the peak of your identity, it crumbles under that weight. Can't handle it. And then we're only left wanting and searching for more. Wanting and searching for something else. And so when we talk about gospel identity, it's saying that we want to find our identity solely firm in the gospel message of who Jesus is and what He's done on my behalf, and He has brought me into right relationship with God. And so I know even initially saying that, some of you are thinking, I get that. We've heard the gospel before and we've talked about the gospel before, and I believe that, but what does that have to do with my identity? Unfortunately, many of us have a very truncated view of what the gospel is. We see it as a way to get into heaven or simply just get into God's kingdom. But the gospel is so much more than that. It's not just the door, but it's actually the path to walk for everyday life. It's not just the means of our salvation, but it's also the means of our transformation. It's not simply deliverance from sin's penalty, but it's also a release from sin's power in our lives. You see, the gospel makes us right with God, and in theology terms, that's justification. The gospel makes us right with God, and then it also frees us to delight in God and become like our Savior, and that's a theological term, sanctification, becoming like Christ. So the gospel has the power to do both of those things in our lives. And so the gospel is everything for us if we're going to have a gospel identity to understand it and to live it. We need to see that the gospel is not just simply A, B, C, but it's actually the A through Z for our entire life. And so as we talk about a gospel identity, we're even going to be thinking about, okay, what is the gospel? And so I'm going to assume you know nothing, not because you know nothing, but for this course, for our first lesson today, we're going to think about, if we didn't know what the gospel is, how can I best understand what we're being invited into? And we're first going to look at a verse that many have seen as a common presentation of the gospel. I mean, growing up, I never went to church, but I always saw John 3:16 on the signs at like wrestling arenas, or at football arenas, or, you know, there's athletes with the eye black that say John 3:16. And I remember, I'm like, John 3:16 p.m. a.m. I don't know what is this going on. But as time's gone, I've come to understand, oh, it's actually a gospel proclamation that we see within the scriptures. And Jesus is saying this. He's in an interaction with somebody named Nicodemus. Nicodemus comes to Jesus and is asking a lot of questions about who Jesus is, because he was doing things that was miraculous. He was teaching things that nobody has ever heard before. And so Nicodemus comes to Jesus and asks, what is this all about? And Jesus responds to him saying, for you to understand, to enter, to be in right relationship with God, you have to be born again. And this conversation goes on, and Jesus says this, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And so even within this passage, we see Jesus begin to break down, even in itself, what the gospel is, because it says, as Nicodemus came to him identifying issues and problems in his life and his understanding and in his even his religious beliefs, Jesus is saying our sin has actually separated us from God, being the main problem. And he says God loved the world, so he loves a lot of people, a great deal of people. And so when we even think about salvation, yes, it's important that we understand that Jesus has died for me, but we also need to understand that Jesus invites us into a greater relationship, not just with God, but other people as well. So he loves the world, so he gave his only son. So even first and foremost, if you're taking notes, the very first thing that I want you to know is God loves you. He does. Your warts and all, your mistakes and all, because of what Jesus, because, and it's exampled because he sent his son Jesus for you. That's the one of the first things to understand in having a gospel identity, that God loves you and is for you despite your sins. Christ comes to deal with your sins. And we say that because Jesus says it, that God gave his only son, meaning that Jesus has died for you, for your sins, in your place, the punishment and the wrath that you deserve. God gave Christ to take those from you and took the penalty for himself. And it says that everybody who would believe in him, meaning if you believe in Jesus, you will have eternal life. So even from the get-go, having a gospel understanding is just simply understanding what the gospel is. And Jesus even further emphasizes this in his teaching in John 17 when he says this, this is eternal life, that they know you, speaking to God. This is part of his high priestly prayer right before he goes to the cross to be crucified. He's praying to God. He's asking, God, would your people know that you, Father, are the one true God and Jesus Christ whom you've sent? So he's asking and hoping that people would see that eternal life, solution to the world's greatest problems for your soul, is found in Jesus. That's the very first fundamental thing that we have to understand. If we're going to have a gospel identity, that Christ has died for us, that God is for us, and God loves us. You see, the main goal and driver in your life is to know God. Most of your problems will fall into proper place once we know, we are aware of the fact that we are made to know God and that God loves us. You see, the Apostle Paul even continues on taking this idea of what the gospel is in 1 Corinthians 15. He says this, for I delivered to you as of first importance of what I've received. So he's coming to the church in Corinth and saying, the very first thing that I taught you is the very most important thing. The Apostle Paul, if you've read through the book of 1 Corinthians, he talks a lot about a lot of things. In fact, he has a second letter, 2 Corinthians, in our Bible, and there's even hints of that there was another letter to the Corinthian church that we don't have. But he's saying, of all the things that I taught you, of all the things that you needed to know, the thing of first importance, the thing that I taught you, which he has also received, was this, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day, in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, Peter, then to the 12. And so even this gospel message tells us a few things. Again, reemphasizing even Jesus's message from the Gospel of John. Christ has died for our sins to bring about forgiveness. And I love that the Apostle Paul says that in accordance with the scriptures, meaning that this promise is something that has been fulfilled in Christ. If you're not familiar with your Old Testament, there's this promise all throughout it of this coming Messiah who would bring God's people back to him, who would rescue them, who had redeemed them. And what Paul is saying, Jesus is that person. His death fulfilled all the promises in the Old Testament. And when he says he was buried, he's just simply pointing to the evidence that that actually happened. He was buried. And then he continues on to say that he was raised on the third day, talking about the newness of life. Because that's the biggest thing when we are talking about understanding and living our gospel identity. It means that we have a newness of life to step into. And again, Paul again emphasizes that this was in accordance to the scriptures. This is something that God has been intending for all along. This wasn't a backup plan. This is what God has intended all along, that there would be a forgiveness of sins and there would be a newness of life, and that would be found solely in Christ. And when he mentions that it says he appeared to Cephas, he's saying there's evidence. You can go talk to the people. At the time when the Apostle Paul wrote this, you could still talk to many of those people who saw Jesus appear. And so for us, we have to see that a gospel-shaped life, a life of living and understanding our gospel identity, is rooted and grounded with these truths. A life that is marked by forgiveness from God, and a life that is marked by a newness of life that is brought by Jesus. And so if we're talking about a relationship with God, and God, this is what he's done for us, what exactly does this life look like? And the very first thing, and this is teased out in our very first book by Gary Miller, and he talks about our relationship with God is first theological. I know sometimes we can get really overwhelmed, intimidated, thinking about theological, like, whoa, wait a second. I didn't know I was signing up for one of those courses way in there. But really, the fact of the matter is, theology is simply the study of God. So if you ever think about God, what he's like, what he's done, if you ever think about your relationship with him, if you ever think about how God is working in somebody else's life, guess what? You are a theologian. You don't necessarily have to go off to fancy schools and get fancy degrees to be considered a theologian. If you simply study God and think about God, you're a theologian. So the very first thing that we need to understand is that our relationship with God is one of theology. And so there's a few things that I'm going to assume based upon our time together in this course, and Sarah, as she helps teaches this course, there's a few things that we're going to assume. The first thing is that the God of the Bible exists, that the way that he is revealed within the scriptures, this God is true. He's real, he's knowable, that what is said about him in these pages is factual. So we're going to assume that. We're not going to do necessarily a ton of apologetic work to get you there, that's for another time, but we're going to assume that God of the Bible exists and is real. Secondly, because of that, we believe that God has revealed himself, meaning that he wants to be known. And so when I was in middle school and in high school and a little bit of college, I took Spanish courses. And I only know enough Spanish to get me into a little bit of trouble. And when we learn different verbs and conversations, there's this different concepts of what it means to know things. So there's the idea of saber, which is simply just to know facts or a learned skill. And so a perfect example is this, like, I know details about somebody because I looked up their Wikipedia page or because I just kind of know facts about them. So like, I know that Ken Griffey Jr.'s hands down the best baseball player that ever existed and probably ever will. I know that he was born on November 21st, that his dad played baseball, that he is in the Major League Baseball Hall of Fame, that he had huge deals with Nike and Nintendo and had the best video games for baseball when I was growing up. I know that he played for the best team in the world, the Seattle Mariners, and other teams like the Cincinnati Reds and the Chicago White Sox. So I know these things about him, but I don't know him. And if you were to ask him about Kyle Wetzler, he'd be like, who? No idea who I am. So there's a certain level of I know him, but I don't actually know him. So that's in the Spanish word, that's saber. But deeper, there's this idea of conocer, that there's this deep familiarity. There's this acquaintance language. And so for a perfect example is, I deeply know who my wife is, what she's like, and what she's not. I'm intimately aware of not just facts about her height or facts about when her birthday is, but I know what makes her tick. I know what brings a smile to her face. I know when I see her at different times, man, she's having a hard time with this, or she had a good day with this. Or when she gets time with a girlfriend, how different things in her life, just a weight comes off. And so I know things about her because I have intimate knowledge of her. But if I were to tell you, my wife is 6'4", played college volleyball on a full ride scholarship, and she's an engineer and is building a bridge somewhere. Those of you who know me, know my wife, are asking, Kyle, do you actually know your wife? Because if you actually do know my wife, you know she's not 6'4". You know that she did not play college volleyball, and because of her height, probably never would have been offered a scholarship for volleyball. And she's not an engineer. So when we talk about knowing God, we actually need to make sure we know the God that we're talking about. We actually need to know the God of the scriptures. So we just don't know facts about him. We want to actually know him. And that's a big key of having a gospel identity. And so it's theological and it's also personal. You know, it's staggering but true that those who know God are in a relationship with him. We're seen as co-heirs, co-workers, and personal friends. That language is all throughout the scriptures. Those who know God, he loves them. He cares for them. Jesus calls us his friend. That communicates to us great value and worth. Even think of what Jesus says here in Luke 12, verses 4 through 7. He says, I tell you, my friends, do not fear those who kill the body, and after that have nothing more that they can do. But I will warn you whom to fear. Fear him who not after he kills has authority to cast you into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. Are not five sparrows sold for 2 pennies? And not one of them is forgotten before God? Why, even the hairs on your head are all numbered. Fear not. You are more value than many sparrows. And so I know that passage incites a lot of different things because of what it's communicating, but the one thing I really want us to tease out and understand here is that he knows us extremely well. I know my wife very well, but I don't know the number of hairs on her head. I could count, but that would take a long time, and then I'd probably lose count somewhere because I only have 20 fingers and toes. But Jesus knows those things about me. He has this deep, intimate, personal knowledge, understanding of who I am. So even when you think about the person who knows you the best, their knowledge pales in comparison to what Jesus knows of you. And so he even, elsewhere in the scripture, it teaches this idea in Psalm 139. It says this, the psalmist is speaking to God, for you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. Just look at the rich imagery that the psalmist is teasing out. God knows him even before he was fully formed and out on this earth. My frame was not hidden from you. When I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me. When I was yet, there was none of them. So God's knowing God is a deeply personal thing. It's a theological thing, things that we know with our minds, and it's deeply personal things that we feel within our heart. And then also, knowing God is experiential. I'm going to share with you a passage in the book from 1 Kings. And Elijah is a prophet of God who is, during different parts of his ministry and his life, faced opposition, faced struggle and hardship. And there's this story that talks about how he has experienced God. And it says this in 1 Kings 19. And he said, God, meaning, go out and stand on the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore the mountains and broke at the pieces of the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? You see, the prophet experienced this moment experientially, hearing, seeing, experiencing God. And it wasn't necessarily in the loudest things. It wasn't in the earthquake. It wasn't in the fire. It wasn't in the wind. It was in the small, low whisper. And so there is a sense in which we're going to experience God by God's grace together as we walk through this course that we might not necessarily place a finger on, but we could say, I experienced God in some way through this course, through my study. I learned about him. I experienced him with my heart. I knew how he knew me. But there's also something experientially that we had. Because as we learn to know about God and grow in God, we are moved to awe of him and worship him. But there's one thing that I will say before we go on from this point is that we live in a day when personal experience is elevated above everything else. And it's the final criteria of right and wrong. Experience can be and should teach us, but it can never be the final authority on anything. That role belongs to God and the word in which he gives us by the standards in which he interacts with us. And so when we experience God, we should always anchor it and tie it back to making sure that's something biblical. And so we know that one of the ways that Jesus speaks to us, one of the ways God speaks to us now is through his word, through his Bible. Because we know these 66 books communicate the same message to us over, while they may be written at different times, talking about different situations, ultimately the entire Bible is teaching us the one message of the gospel of grace, that Christ has come to be a forgiveness of our sins, to bring us to a newness of life. And so, in summary, as we kind of conclude here today, is what matters is not the fact that I know God, but that he knows me. And I want that to sit with us for a little bit, that it's not just simply that we're going to take this course so we know him better, which is a great thing, but he knows you deeply and intimately. And so maybe you've been walking with Jesus for a long time. My prayer and my hope is that even as some of what we've been talking about today may seem repetitive and nothing new, but I pray that as we've been speaking and learning and reading together, a new sense of awe and wonder has been stirred in your heart and in your mind. That this isn't simply just an academic exercise for us, but as we look at these passages and are reminded of what Christ has done for us, it would illuminate in us and stir in us awe and worship of the fact that we know God and he knows us. And that is the key to understanding our gospel identity. And so I'm encouraged by how our author in the book talked about 2 Timothy 2:8. And he says, he brings out this passage saying, remember Jesus Christ risen from the dead. Again, the Apostle Paul is consumed with reminding us of the gospel, of what Christ has accomplished. We often forget about who Jesus is. We often forget about what he's done. We often forget about what that means for you and I. And so if you signed up to take this course looking to dive deeper into the deep end of the pool, I'm thankful for that. But I want to let you know, and I hope that you're not disappointed in, when we continue to reveal to you and teach to you to show you that Jesus himself is the deep end of that pool. That as we grow and study together, that we're not just simply trying to get greater knowledge of more fine-tuned things in the scriptures, but we're actually getting a heart that is fully engulfed in the love of Christ. So as we do various readings, listens to different sessions, engage in different conversations, may you remember Jesus Christ, who has risen from the dead for you and I. Those who maybe have gone to church for a long time or would be familiar with the Westminster Catechism. And the first question, the catechisms are often shared with just helping people learn basic things about the faith. And the first question is from it is, what is the chief end of man? What is the main purpose of man? And it says this, man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. And so my prayer and hope for this course is that we would glorify God and enjoy him, because that is the foundational piece of understanding and living a gospel identity. And so as we close, I want to read over you one of my favorite psalms. It's a little bit long, so I'd even encourage you, if you want to sit back and close your eyes, or if you have your Bible, you could turn there with me and read along with me. It's Psalm 145. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds and on the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his works, and kind in all his works. The Lord upholds all those who are falling, and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand, and you satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and kind in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call on him and to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desire of those who fear him, and he also hears their cries and saves them. The Lord preserves all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. This is who our God is. This is where our gospel identity is rooted in. And so as we conclude, I want to give you one minor little exercise for your week. In the reading, we talked and saw about how the author wrote out what the gospel is, and even just a short sentence in a tweet, I think he even mentioned it. He says this: the gospel is the announcement of what the triune God has done in Christ to make it possible for us to know him and enjoy him forever. So this week, what I want to encourage you to do is try it yourself. How would you describe and write out what the gospel is? The very thing in which we're building our identity on. So as you study this week, as you pray this week, and as you get ready to join us in conversation later on, may the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you. May he give you this. May he give you his peace as you search his word. We'll see you soon.